knows my heart beating, 'cause you are the reason I'm losing my sleep. Please come back now. And there goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hopeless now. I'd climb every mountain and swim every ocean just to be with you and fix what I broke. Oh, 'cause I need you to see that you are the reason. Turn back the clock, I'd make sure the light defeated the dark. I'd spend every hour of every day keeping you safe. And I'd climb every
Thank you. We're so excited to tell you that at this moment, we have near 1,400 participants from 85 countries and 6 continents around the world.
That today, we have near 1,000 participants from 53 countries across 6 continents.
We are so excited to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 76 countries across 6 continents.
So we are very, very excited to inform you that at this moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 74 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would also like to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 81 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would like to inform you as well that at this very moment, we have nearly 1,000 participants from 65 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would like to inform you as well that at this very moment, we have near 1,000 participants from 61 countries across 6 continents around the world.
Time is yours. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Leap off. Let's go.
Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure to speak with you. Nice to meet you over Zoom. It's interesting
so
that
much.
We meet people now across the world all the time.
And leap off. Give applause to Amar Agarwal.
Thank you very, very much, first of all, to entire Indonesia and also to all the 1,400 delegates watching from 85 countries.
Applause. Godspeed, my rejoicing.
Thank you very much for this extremely kind invitation and, of course, a very beautiful
introduction.
Thank you very much.
Time is yours. Leave off. Go ahead, Boris.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Gede, Pardianto, and all Indonesian ophthalmologists that were being so kind to invite me.
Applause!
Thank you so much, really, for organizing something like this, because it really kind of opens up so many channels of education.
Applause!
Well, thank you very much for the very kind of it and how many international respondents you have. You obviously, the whole world is watching Indonesia.
Time is yours. Leave off. Here we go, David. It is showtime.
Thank you all and everyone be safe. And I hope all of you around the world, how many people you reach with this. It's great. It's a great service. You're doing a great job. My congratulations.
Time is yours. Leave off.
Thank you very much. Konnichiwa, good morning. This is my first webinar using the Zoom. Thank you.
Time is yours. Leap off. Applause. Godspeed, Dr. Firna, Sri Oksariana.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a very kind introduction for me, Dr. Gede. I'm very honored to be here. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Leap off. Applause. Godspeed, Richard Factor.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Thank you so much for asking me, Gede, to be part of this wonderful series of webinars that you've been doing.
Aniba! Go ahead, Priya.
Thank you so much. I mean, I do not really have words to express how I'm feeling right now, but Dr. Gede Pardianto, I am totally blown out by this. Thank you so much for having me here and the entire Indonesian society.
Leap off!
Thank you very much, my good friend, Dr. Gede. I'd like to thank Dr. Pardianto right at the outset for inviting me to this fascinating one-hour maestro session.
Time is yours. Leap off! Applause!
Thank you. Thank you very much for this great introduction. I think it's the best introduction I ever had in my life.
Time is yours, Lito! Godspeed, De Sunti.
Thank you for such a warm welcome and an awing introduction. Thank you so much for this great opportunity and this wonderful webinar reaching out to everyone around the world. I'm amazed at all the people around the world with
Kota Cataract di Indonesia, menuju Indonesia maju sejahtera. SMEC Group majulah, SMEC Group jayalah, SMEC Group pilihanku, SMEC Group tukang sahur.
Here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I did not know no pain, when I believed in forever and everything would stay the same. Now my heart feel like December when somebody say your name, cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day, hey. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, hey, hey. But everything gon' be alright, gon' raise a glass and say hey. Here's to the ones that we got, cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. Memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I never felt so lost, and I felt all of the hatred was too powerful to stop. Now my heart feel like an ember and it's lighting up the dark. I'll carry these torches for ya, and you know I'll never drop. Yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright, gonna raise a glass and say hey. Here's to the ones that we got, oh, cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your.
Good evening to all the honorable doctors participating at this webinar. Good evening to for our special guest today, Professor Zoltan Nagy from Hungary. Thank you so much for your time to share your knowledge in this International Ophthalmology Webinar Series, 1 hour with the Maestro. I am Dr. Diah Purworini, a committee member of this program. And now please allow me to host and guide today's webinar as a master of ceremony. To all the participating doctors, absolutely, we are very happy to see all of you again in this 15th episode. Your attendance and participation means a lot to us, and we really appreciate it. For this 15th episode, like the previous ones, this webinar series is faithfully supported by Sabang Merauke Eye Center, or SMEC Hospital, Indonesian Ophthalmologist Association North Sumatra Branch, and Indonesian Doctor Association Medan Branch, and also North Sumatra Branches. And especially for this episode, also supported by PT Sunbeer Vision. To all of them that we mentioned above, we are very grateful for their support. We would like to inform you as well that at this very moment, we have nearly 1,000 participants from 63 countries across 6 continents around the world, streaming from Zoom and YouTube. So now, let's start this webinar. Our speaker today is Professor Zoltan Nagy, MD, PhD, DSc, FIBO from Hungary. Professor Zoltan Nagy is a professor and a dean of Semmelweis University Faculty of Health Sciences. Related to that, he is a director of Department of Ophthalmology, Semmelweis University. He is also a chair of supervisory board of Association of Hungarian Medical Societies. At this moment, he will present a very interesting topic with the title Femtosecond Laser Cataract Surgery. Audiences, our moderator today is the course director of our webinar series, Dr. Gede Pardianto. He is a refractive surgeon in SMEC Eye Hospital, Medan, North Sumatra. And this time, Dr. Gede will be accompanied by Dr. Andrea Silitonga as the co-moderator. She is a retinal surgeon at the same eye hospital. And like the previously, this webinar will be divided into two sessions. The first session is an online course, and the second session is a question and answer or Q&A session. So please feel free to drop your questions to the Q&A box. Once again, please, in the Q&A box and not in the chat box. This is to make us easier to compile all the questions so there are no questions that left behind to read to the speakers. Thank you for your cooperation. Also, for our participants who perhaps joined this webinar in our YouTube channel, don't be hesitant to write your questions in the live chat feature so that our moderators will be able to read it as well during the Q&A session. And so, absolutely, it will make our speaker be able to answer it. Our distinguished participants, before we begin this webinar, please pay attention to Indonesian national anthem. Then now, attention please to Hungarian national anthem.
Thank you.
Thank you as well. And now, the first session of this webinar will be started shortly. And I will give this session to our moderator and the co-moderator. Dr. Gede Pardianto and Dr. Andrea Silitonga, the time is all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Dia. Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello, hello. Good afternoon and evening, Indonesia. Good morning, Hungary. Good day for our friends from all the rest of the world. It must be.
Csak rá kéne tenni akkor az előadást.
A hangot lenémítom.
Do you hear me? Hello? Kivettem. I don't hear you. Maybe you're muted.
Yes, Professor, your voice is okay. Clear.
Okay. So I will talk about the femtosecond laser cataract surgery. It's okay for you, technology, techniques, clinical results.
Yes, but excuse us, our moderator still want to introduce you. Please okay, hold on
okay.
For a while. Okay.
I have to leave a bit earlier than 9 o'clock because there's a meeting. Yeah, you know. So about 9:15.
Okay, sure. Okay. We will notice with that, Professor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Csak megoldottuk az utolsó pillanat, de
teher alatt a pálmát, ugye.
Én már nem szeretnék pálmát játszani. De azért ezek olyanok, amit szerintem egy mindennapi szemésztől nem várhatók el a fiataloktól.
Hey, professor, we can continue.
Yes, hello.
Okay, hello, professor. Thank you so much. Very glad for having you today. And fellow ophthalmologists, let's pay attention to Professor Zoltan Zsolt Nagy. So Zoltan, we are counting down for you. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, time is yours. Please all.
Thank you very much. És hogy kell behozni a előadást? Share screen.
Igen.
Okay, we just start. Okay. You see the pictures, yes?
Yes, we can see the picture.
Okay, so I will talk about today the technology, techniques, and clinical results of femtosecond laser-assisted cataract surgery. You know that lasers in ophthalmology is very widely used, from the lowest wavelengths to the longest wavelength. So excimer laser, here you see at the 193 nanometer wavelengths, and the femtosecond laser is at the other end of the electromagnetic spectrum. In between there is argon diode laser, glass laser, and many other things. This is the only visible part of our electromagnetic spectrum, so our eye can perceive between 400 and 700 nanometer. So neither the excimer laser nor the femtosecond laser can be seen by our human eyes. So what is the principle of the femtosecond laser? So small diameter laser impulses have the effect. Microplasm is created and photodisrupting approximately 1 micron thick tissue, and the gas bubble is produced around the laser impulse. This gas bubble containing gas and water. And if we put the impulse is just beside each other, then we receive a plane, a so-called cut plane. So the laser spot creating a cut line within the tissue, and small tissue bridges may remain. So at the beginning, it was quite difficult to lift, let's say, the corner flap. But now with the sophisticated technology, it's much more easier. So these laser impulses can be placed in any direction, vertical and horizontal, and whatever the surgeon would like to have. So I think this principle is very, very important. So this is the so-called intralase femtosecond laser. You see here, here is the laser emission, and then it goes through attenuators, monitors, shutter, safety shutters, mirrors, articulated arm, safety shutter, scanner, objective lens, and mirror until it gets to the patient eye. So it's a very sophisticated and a bit complicated system, but it's working very well. So corneal surgery with the femtosecond laser is possible to perform penetrating keratoplasty with special cut pattern. And also it's a safe and precise method for LASIK flap creation, but also for corneal penetrating keratoplasty. So you can see that you can direct in any direction the laser beam, so it can cut mushroom patterns and whatsoever the surgeon want. So corneal surgery based usually on photo disruption. What is the difference? Femtosecond lasers can cut within the corneal tissue, and also we can direct the laser beam under the cornea, so inside the lens or any ocular structure. On the other hand, excimer laser have precise only superficial effects. So excimer laser act only on the superficial part of the cornea, while femtosecond laser act within the cornea or under the cornea. Femtosecond lasers in ophthalmology is very widely used for cornea, for scleral procedures, for the crystalline lens, and there's a possibility to use it for vitreous cutting or retinal imaging. In the cornea, we can create flaps for LASIK, for transplant procedures, for intrastromal and lenticular procedures, and very important for refractive procedure. within the sclera, you can treat glaucoma treatments. And now there's a new technique with femtosecond laser to perform trabeculotomy. It will come out hopefully within 1 year, this new technology. But it also can be used for presbyopia procedures. In the crystalline lens, I will talk about later for cataract surgery. And in the vitreous and retina, you can use it for vitreous cutting and retinal imaging as well and treatment. In cataract surgery, there are three key steps. One is corneal incision, the second is capsulotomy, and the third is lens fragmentation. What offers this femtosecond laser cataract surgery technology advances all manual procedures into a precise and reproducible laser procedure. So what are steps in cataract surgery? Capsulorhexis, lens liquefaction or lens fragmentation, and corneal wound. These are the main three key steps of corneal surgery. What's happening when something is underused or not well used? If corneal incision not well done, then astigmatism may be a consequence, but also endophthalmitis may be a consequence if it's leaking. If capsulorhexis is not performed on the right way, then the IOL position will be variable, so the effective lens power will be also different or will differ from the attempted refraction. If lens fragmentation goes not well, then there will be a delayed visual recovery, loss of endothelial cells, and rupture of the posterior capsule. This is the LensX laser. Now about 3-4 more platform is existing, but the first treatment in the world was performed in this department where I'm now talking, the library of the Department of Ophthalmology, Semmelweis University. We performed the first treatment in 2008, August. Then 1 year later, the method received the FDA clearance for anterior capsulotomy, corneal incisions, and laser phaco fragmentation. And the first laser refractive surgery was performed in 2010, so 11 years ago in the US. And then it received the CE mark also in the United States and in Europe also, and then also in Australia. So there are some articles here which we published after the first treatment and following the next 2-3 years. I think now many publications you can read in the literature. So the system, how it looks like. There's a screen for the technician and for the doctor. This screen is especially for the treating surgeon, and this part comes into contact with the patient eye. So this is the so-called patient interface. This is the monitor for the anterior segment for the surgeon. And the other one is a monitor for the technical details. So on the monitor, this is an enlarged image. You can set the parameters, so where to cut within the lens, so the lens fragmentation area, the size of capsulotomy and the position of capsulotomy, and also the corneal wound, the main incision, and the side port incisions. With the first OCT image, you identify the anterior capsule, the highest and the lowest part of the anterior capsule. I will show a video later. I hope it's working. The second imaging shows the crystalline lens and where the laser will cut within the crystalline lens. And the third image will show, I will show later, the corneal wound, so the corneal structure. So this is the corneal structure, and this is a biplanar wound. It's designed to be a biplanar, not to open after surgery, so it will create a self-sealing wound. The corneal wound, therefore, is self-sealing, does not open by itself, and incision can be made hours before, not days, especially in the capsulotomy, because lens protein may get free and then inducing unwanted intraocular inflammation and uveitis. The corneal wound does not need to hydrate at the end of surgery, and it's not ruptured or widened during surgery. So this is the image-guided treatment. So one represents the capsulotomy, the other line represents the lens fragmentation or liquefaction, and this is the cross-section of the image. I try to show you some more interesting video. This is the femtocapsulotomy. It's a real-time. So it shows how the capsulotomy is done by the laser. It's really a 10, maximum 15 second procedure. And then with the capsulotomy needle, you can identify the cut line, and then you can take it out as a whole from the eye. Nowadays, we can do it without identifying with the Rexis needle like this, but I suggest to be a bit cautious, because if it's not a complete cut, then there might be some problem, an anterior tear. This is the immediate OCT image. Here you see the cut within the anterior capsule. Here you see the OCT image just in front of the patient. And here you see the cut within the anterior capsule. This is the lens liquefaction. If the lens is not very hard, not very advanced cataract, then I suggest to liquefy the lens. So it goes with concentric rings. And if it's liquefied, then you just make a short hydrodissection, and then you can suck out the lens nucleus without any problem. So you don't need any phaco energy for the surgery. Here you see, just to suck out, and then you can immediately implant the lens within the capsular bag. I hope you can see it quite well, that it's easygoing procedure, so you don't need to enter with the phaco head, not at all. The next, we'll show a real femtocataract surgery. It was some years before. So we identified the central capsulotomy and central fragmentation. If we did it, then we do perform the first OCT imaging. This is the lowest and highest part of the anterior capsule. The second OCT identifies the lens. This is where we will cut within the lens. And the third is the biplanar wound, identifying the corneal structure. And then I just step on the pedal, and then the first procedure is capsulotomy. The second is cut within the cataractous lens. So this is a cross pattern cut. And the third is the main incision and the side port incisions. And then during surgery, we just fill up the anterior chamber. So this is identifying the corneal wounds. Then we fill up the anterior chamber with viscoelastic. And then we identify the capsulotomy, and then just take it out as a whole. At the beginning, I went around the laser cut, not to have any bridges. And then you see, just grab the lens, and then with this chopper, we can already halve it. And then I make another quarter from the lens. And then you can easily grab it and phaco, emulsifying, and then coming the next quarter of the lens, crystalline lens. So this is it. And at the end, this is the lens implantation with the lens implantation. So then we performed a quite big study. So first of all, we analyzed the laser capsulotomy results. We achieved perfect centration during the study. The precision of the diameter was within plus minus 0.25 millimeter. No radial tears occurred. It was easy and complete, the removal of the capsule. And we experienced no adverse effect at all. So this was the first phase of the study. About the diameter accuracy, so then we compared how it works with manual capsulotomy and how it works with the femtolaser assisted capsulotomy. And then what we found out that only 10% of the manual capsulotomies were within 0. Plus minus 25 millimeter of accuracy. Here you see down, the red represents the manual capsulotomy, the white represents the flux capsulotomy. So only 10%, then about 50% were within 0.5, plus minus 0.5 millimeter of accuracy. And within plus minus 1.25 millimeter, all eyes were within that range. The second was the analyzing the wound structure. So this is an eye with 2 weeks post-op with OCT. And here you see a very nice laser cut, well opposing inside and well opposing outside the corneal wound. Then we analyze the centration with femtosecond laser capsulotomy and with manual capsulotomy. It was a comparative prospective study, included 40 eyes of femtolaser capsulotomy and 40 eyes with manual CCC. The IOL centration was measured 1 week, 1 month, and 1 year after surgery in a postoperative retroillumination photos. Here you see how it's covered the anterior capsule of the optic of the intraocular lens, and is there any decentration? What we found, this is the article which I quote, the size of the capsulotomy was better controlled and it's more reproducible compared to manual capsulotomy. Circularity of the femtosecond laser capsulotomy was significantly better, and there was a better coverage of the PCR by the anterior capsule of the femtolaser capsulotomies, and it created a better IOL centration, of course, because if capsulotomy is regular, covering like here, better the anterior part of the lens optic compared to this one, then centration and the high order aberration results are better. So what about PCR tilt? This is an important issue because it is responsible for, let's say, night vision problems, dim light problems. So when the patient says that, I don't see so well, doctor, I cannot differentiate of the traffic lamps or the traffic charts. So these are important things. And you see the horizontal tilt, vertical tilt, and the vertical tilt more than 5 degrees was compared. And then we throw a line along the implanted posterior chamber lens. And what we found that in femtolaser treated eyes, the tilt was better, significantly better compared to traditional manual phaco emulsification. And this vertical and horizontal tilt were significantly better. What about the effective lens position in all timeline, pre-op, not pre-op, post-op, immediately 1 week and 1 month post-operatively, all eyes treated with femtosecond laser capsulotomy did better analyzing effective lens position. If we modelize the vision quality with the NIDAC OPD scan equipment, higher order aberration showed also better results with internal vertical tilt and internal vertical coma in the femtosecond laser treated groups. The image what we received after such treatment in the femtolaser group was more point-like compared to the more coma-like in the traditional group manual or traditional phaco emulsification group. Also, when MTF modulation transfer function was examined, then the quality of vision did in all parameters did better the femtosecond laser treated eyes. Here you see the results down here in the chart. What about the time-wise and also the phaco power of the two operation method? If we compare femtolaser treated group, there we achieve immediately 43% reduction in average phaco power. So therefore, I think it's a quite big difference. Almost half of the phaco power could be spared with the femtolaser group because it was pre-treated with the phaco fragmentation. What about the effect on the cornea? So one day post-op, in the femtosecond laser group, there was less corneal edema, less thickness changes compared to control group. In the femtolaser group, average corneal thickness was not more than 580 micron, while in the traditional group, it was 620-630. And this difference, 1 month later, already couldn't shown. So both methods are safe and good and effective. I was in the first postoperative day, the femtosecond laser treated eyes did better. I think especially in corneal patients, when there is a Fuchs dystrophy or any other corneal dystrophy, it's very important to use the femtolaser technology because it can spare corneal edema. Another safety issue is the macula. Is there any effect of femtosecond laser on the macula? So femtolaser assisted cataract surgery also showed some beneficial effect regarding the macula. The inner macular layer, I'll show you here, was significantly less thickened following cataract surgery, following femtolaser assisted cataract surgery compared to traditional phaco emulsification group. So a very big advantage is treating traumatic cataract and femtosecond laser. I had a 38-year-old male. He was a car racer. So his profession was racing with cars. So therefore, vision, I think, is of utmost importance for her. Then he had some household injury. An iron particle injured his eye, and it caused an anterior capsular injury with a consecutive traumatic cataract. Here you see the cataract, and here you see the OCT imaging. The lens in this part is swollen, and some part of the lens is bulging out. The trauma, I try to show you, was somewhere here, and this iron particle hit the capsule and also made an opening in the capsule. So with traditional manual capsulotomy, I think it would not be possible to do a capsular ring shape capsulotomy. So therefore, the lens position would have been in danger. And his preoperative vision was finger counting, and postoperatively, it was possible performing capsulotomy with the femtosecond laser to achieve a circular capsulotomy and to achieve a very nice capsulotomy. And so I was able to implant the posterior capsular lens within the capsular bag. So immediately he was able to go back to his activity and to continue as a car racer. So this is the postoperative image, slit lamp image of that eye. What about complications? We had complications only during the first 100 cases and later nothing. So we achieved a suction break in 2 persons, so 2 eyes from the 100. But now with the new soft fit procedure, there's no suction break, only if something goes wrong or the patient makes a very sudden and very severe move of the head. The endothelial cut, when we started the method, there was no OCT, so we could judge the depth of the anterior chamber only by previous preoperative measurements. And so in one case, there was some endothelial damage, but the coroner did not decompensate it. Anterior capsular tear also during the first three cases from the first 100 surgery, it was in 3%. Now, if you follow my advice that to do a rock and roll technique with the lens nucleus, and before you do this, follow the cut line of the laser cut, and then remove the anterior capsule, you have no anterior capsular tear. Meiosis we experience in 1/3 of the eyes, and now it's less than, I would say, 10%. Conjunctival redness in 30%, and capsular blockage syndrome, none of the cases. In Australia, 6 surgeons started the procedure simultaneously without any previous real thoughtful education. So therefore, after capsulotomy and lens cut, they just made the hydrodissection with a very abrupt injecting the fluid under the capsule. So there was no room to remove the air bubble, which created, or gas bubble, which was created within the nucleus. And so where it went, not anteriorly, but posteriorly. So it caused a rupture of the posterior capsule. But if you do a thoughtful and not sudden hydrodissection, that you never experience that. So I think now it goes to some theoretical experiments. The biomechanical stability of the anterior capsule following flux and following manual capsulotomy. So it was a very nice study. Usually the capsulotomy should be mechanically ideal, so resistance to some forces. And in case of anterior tear, IOL tear, malposition, posterior capsule rupture may occur. And the most frequently used technique so far, the manual CCC. Advantage mechanically, this mechanical circular CCC usually strong and flexible. And there's a new possibility with the femtolaser capsulotomy, which we should examine, that is it so strong and flexible as manual CCC. To examine biomechanically the anterior capsular capsulotomy following, and then we created two groups, manual CCC and femtosecond laser created CCC. So 80 fresh pig eyes were included into that groups, a cystotome and a rexis forceps, so it was a manual CCC, and the femtosecond laser group, of course, it was a femtosecond laser to create the capsulotomy. Then we removed the cornea and the iris, and the anterior capsule remover with capsule scissors around the lens equator was done. Two universities participated, one Semmelweis University, Department of Ophthalmology, then Department of Polymer Technology of the Technical University of Budapest, and Universal Mechanical Testing Equipment from Zwickau, from Ulm, Germany. So what we evaluated, it's very important, circumference stretching and the rupture force, and the force displacement curve was were evaluated. So we created this capsular ring here, and we put it in the test machine, and we exerted millinewton force, so just we stretched it away, and then the computer detected force displacement, rupture force, and circumference force. So we stretched it, and in the next moment, it ruptured. So then we evaluated how much stress it needed, and so how long it can be stretched. We used scanning electron microscopic electron microscopy for the experiment, glutaraldehyde, paraformaldehyde, series of ethanol dilutions, dry vacuum, and spatial coated. Okay. Then results, very important. Manual groups, results show big differences. So these are ruptured in a very slight force, and these are ruptured in a quite high, 3 times higher force. So it's quite uneven. Predictability is somewhere here. Regarding the femtosecond laser group, displacement force was somewhat lower than in the normal control eyes, but results were more unique. So there was not so big difference in the lowest and in the highest force needed to achieve a capture rupture. So I think it's very important that with the femtosecond laser group, results are more equalized and more predictable. It's somewhat lower, but more stable. So here you see again with the numbers, rupture force, circumference stretching ratio, and so on. I don't go into details. You can see it with your own eyes. This is again the same results. Here you see manual capsule orexis, CCC, and femtosecond laser group. There was a big difference, not very big difference, but the deviation, the standard deviation, was much lower in the femtosecond laser group. This is the rupture force, and this is the circumference stretching ratio. So in that respect, also the femtosecond laser group did better than manual capsule orexis. This is the probability of capture at tear. This is the red dot represents the CCC, and the blue triangle represents the femtosecond laser capsulotomies. So you see that until a certain part, the two things meet and they run quite parallel. And then the femtosecond laser group grows a bit quicker than the manual capsule orexis. So then we examined also the edge of the capsule orexis. Manual capsule orexis looks like the edge like this. And in femtosecond laser capsule orexis looks like this. So it's a bit more comb-like, more uneven. But if you go down with the energy, but not very much, then you receive more smooth capsular edge, which quite resembles to the manual capsular orexis. So I think creating anterior capsulotomy, you should not go with high energy because it can be dangerous. So in this model, femtosecond laser capsulotomy had less variability. So more predictable compared to the manual curvilinear capsule axis. But femtosecond laser group yielded a better, much better mechanical reliability. So I think this is a result that it ruptures with a lower force, but you can predict much more the strengths, that how much strength you needed for cutting it. So it's like manual capsule orexis the cat and femtosecond laser capsule orexis the mouse. Then we examined during another study the pre-treatment with non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs. Does it help or not preventing meiosis, possible meiosis after femtosecond laser pre-treatment? So as I mentioned that the early phase during the first 100 eyes, constricted pupils after flex pre-treatment was a problem in 1/3 of the eye. So we tried to look for possible causes and we tried to measure the prostaglandin levels, how it elevates the prostaglandin liver following the femtolaser session. The aim was, is it possible to avoid intraoperative prostaglandin liver elevation? Does the femtolaser induced prostaglandin liver elevation influence intraoperative pupil diameter? So I can say the answer, yes, it does. And can it be avoided? Yes, it can be. But I show the results. So here you see inclusion and exclusion criteria. It's important. No previous ocular surgery, no diabetic patient, because they will definitely be very narrow pupil. History of glaucoma, post-traumatic cataract, history of any ocular inflammation or uveitis. Corticosteroid injection, use of intra or periocular injection or steroids, current use of topical non-steroid anti-inflammatory drops or corticosteroid, use of systemic corticosteroid, they were all exclusion criteria. We created three patient groups. First patient group, traditional phacoemulsification. Second, pre-treated with femtolaser cataract surgery. And the third, femtolaser cataract surgery plus topical non-steroid anti-inflammatory drops. It's nepafenac. And we evaluated the preoperative pupillary diameter, intraoperative pupillary diameter, postoperative pupillary diameter, collected some aqueous and ELISA measurement for prostaglandin level evaluation. Shortly about the results. No significant difference was found in the preoperative anterior chamber in the three different groups, and no significant difference in the intraoperative pupil diameter. There was a significant difference finding prostaglandin level in the anterior chamber in the femtosecond laser group, showing you the results. Preoperatively first, then femtolaser cataract surgery without any non-steroid anti-inflammatory drops, and then it goes down. So there was a massive effect between the prostaglandin level and the method of operation, so with flux. No significant difference between the pupil preoperatively and late postoperatively, and some investigations initiated treatment was. So now what we suggest to use one day preoperatively non-steroid anti-inflammatory drops, and then you get no pupil meiosis, pupillary meiosis during cataract surgery. Because it's quite annoying that you start surgery with femtolaser, then you try to start cataract surgery, and what you experience that a narrow pupil, a patient will start surgery with a narrow pupil, and it's then difficult to dilate. So what about private perirefractive surgery? Today, in 2021, about 36 million cataract surgery is predicted worldwide. And major focus for industry and surgeons, escape from commodity pricing and future market leadership at stake. So you see that it's going up, especially with the premium lenses. We operate younger and younger patients with less and less cataracts. So it was called before the California cataract that this is a non-existing cataract or slight opacification within the lens. Now it's getting more and more popular worldwide to have a early cataract surgery due to presbyopia or any other big refractive error. So in conclusion, what we can say that the laser precise image guided OCT provides a complete control for the surgeons. The IOL centration, the overlap with the anterior capsule, so the centration of the posterior chamber lens is significantly improved in the recent years. there are less higher order aberrations. Therefore, the quality of vision improved with lens-X capsulotomy. It's very important. And basic research should help and will help, hopefully, ophthalmologists to avoid possible complications such as pupillary constrictions, weak capsulotomy, and intraocular lens decentration. They often ask that will femtosecond laser technology replace phaco emulsification or phaco technology? The answer is definitely no. The femtosecond laser will not replace traditional phaco emulsification. It will replace the unnecessary manual steps or incisions executed during capsulotomy, then lens fragmentation, and then corneal wound. And the lens removal is more efficient with femtolaser technology. What is the ultimate goal of laser refractive cataract surgery? To give the patient a premium surgical experience, and also for the surgeons, and the procedure to be performed with confidence and high predictability. This is, I think, very important, especially with premium lenses. If surgery goes well, then you can use all advantage of the premium lenses. If surgery goes not well, then you cannot use all advantages. For example, blurred vision or diopter changes or whatsoever. So I think good surgical technique is really mandatory for premium lens. So this is the former James Bond. You see Roger Moore. He was operated by femtolaser technology when he had cataract in Switzerland. And so he was very thankful because it went well and then he regained full visual acuity. And then he sent me this picture. With this image, I would like to thank for your attention. And if there's any question, then I can answer you with pleasure. As a remark, I would like to say that my aim was always to have a combined femtolaser equipment, which can treat cornea, which can treat crystalline lens, and which can treat let's say glaucoma. So it seems that it will come true. Now there's a laser, a femtolaser, which can treat cornea. It can perform LASIK procedure, intrastroma procedure, and then real corneal transplant procedure, so full thickness corneal cut. There's the second generation of laser is very good for crystalline lens procedures. So it can treat a cataract lens and also non-cataract lenses only for treating presbyopia, the patient. So it's the clear lens extraction, the CLE. And now in the horizon, it's entering or rising up a new kind of laser, which is called for femto trabeculotomy, which, as I mentioned, will be shown hopefully in next year. So once again, many thanks for your attention. And if you have questions, then I can answer happily. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Zoltan. What a flawless lecture, Zoltan. Remarkable presentation. What?
Thank you.
That was immaculate.
Thank you very much. And my all kind regards to all Indonesian colleagues. And you have a beautiful country and hopefully very nice weather. Now here it's autumn. It's still nice weather and not very cold. And I would like to visit you personally and hopefully it can come true within 1 or 2 years, because hopefully the COVID era will go down and we can freely travel again. I hope the COVID situation is nice in Indonesia and you have no many patients. Here now it's autumn. In autumn and winter time, it's always increasing the numbers. But I think this wave is not so bad as it was before.
Thank you so much. And thank we you. Definitely want to go to Budapest too, the great and so beautiful country.
Thank you.
And, yeah, thank you. And there are so many questions for you, Zoltan. Do you have time?
A little time I have, but I will start another meeting. Therefore, I asked for starting it 1 hour earlier than it was planned before. But please, I try to see the Q&A.
Yeah. There are so many questions.
I can. After 13 years experience, what percentage of your cataract surgery is flex? It's because it's a paying procedure. It's about between 30-40%. In a private practice, if I would operate only in a private practice, that it would be much higher. How often do you see capsular bridges or tags? Now with the new patient interface, I don't see anymore these bridges, so I can freely take out the anterior capsule. But still, because we had some at the beginning, I follow the contour of the laser cut. What are your recommendations for flex in major cataract, myopic, meiotic pupil, traumatic cataract, congenital cataract? So in major cataract is good. When it's very major, then it's good for capsulotomy. So it will not cut, not will do an efficient fragmentation. For a pediatric cataract surgery, it's very good. And for traumatic cataract, it's even better. So I would recommend it for both of them. Some questions disappearing. But try to. What are your recommendations for changing from manual phacoemulsification into flex? So I think it should be a respectful attitude. So it's a different surgery, and be careful with the removing the anterior capsule, and be very gentle with the hydro dissection. This is what I recommend. So not very high pressure hydro dissection. And try to make this rock and roll technique. So you put in some fluid, and then you press down a little bit the nucleus, then up, and then by this way, the gas bubble will allow to come forward and to leave the eye through the anterior corneal wound. If you don't do this and very abrupt hydro dissection you do, then the problem that it will go backward, and then it will it can create a posterior capsular tear. Do you recommend femtosecond posterior capsulotomy in children or adults? In children, yes. In adults, no, because it's you need a double PI, and then it might be a bit more expensive. But I think in children, definitely, I would recommend. Do you have experience of femtosecond laser use for IOL cut and exchange? No, this I don't have experience for IOL cut and exchange. What is your opinion about concept of full automation of cataract surgery by flex and changing of surgeon role to or by technician's role in the near future? It's a very bad opinion I have. So I think we still need good surgeons, because it cannot be fully automated, the femtosecond laser procedure. I think femtosecond laser technology helps good surgeons. So we need good surgeons. And I do hope that in our life, robotics will not take over our part in ophthalmology, because we treat human beings, and human beings needed to treat human beings. Can we use femto laser in major cataract, and does it decrease risk of Argentina flag? Yes, of course, it does decrease the risk for Argentinian flag. In major cataract, in tumescent cataract, it's very, very useful. So even if it's not a full cut, because there's a tilt of the crystalline lens, then you can suck out some lens cortex, and then to continue the capsulotomy. So I think it's really a good one procedure in major cataract. But in this tumescent cataract, the laser will not cut within the lens nucleus. In pediatric cases, what additional measurements should be taken? I think you should do a very thoughtful preoperative OCT measurement, because some pediatric cataract can be a membranous like cataract, and it means that it's very thin. So if you see that it's a normal lens, but it's only a cataractous lens, then you can perform anterior capsulotomy. And when you sucked out the lens and filled up with viscoelastics, then you can perform as a second phase the posterior capsulotomy. So I think in pediatric cataract, it's quite safe and much safer and much better predictable procedure than in manual capsulotomies in pediatric cataract surgery. So I hope that I could answer the questions. And I see that 113 participants, and I would like to greet all of them. And I wish you a very successful and very nice national congress. And with great success in ophthalmology, I think we chosen the best part of medicine, ophthalmology. I think it's in one part the most respectful profession, and also gives the best results and immediate success you can feel when you operated, for example, a cataractous patient, and the next day he fully read the visual chart. And I think this is the best. So thank you very much for your attention and for the invitation and participation in your congress.
Thank you so much. So marvelous. All questions have been answered by our super maestro at this very moment. Great speaker, great audience, so stunning. You all rock. Thank you, SMEC Group. Thank you, EG, Pradabi Sumut. Thank you, Sun Division. Thank you, all committee. And thank you, Dea. And to our super maestro today, Dr. Zoltan Zsolt Nagy. Please send our regard to your family. Thank you so much, Zoltan.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you for this memorable lecture and very nice information you have shared with us this afternoon. Good evening. That was really awesome. Thank you, Zoltan.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
And everyone, see you on the next 1 hour with the maestro. Thank you, my distinguished friend from all around the planet. And further, after 15 episodes, truly, you are all absolutely the best in the world. Here we are spreading love, care, peace, and tranquility on earth. Stay healthy, everybody. Stay wealthy and stay happy. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And then, yeah, the time is all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Gede. All right, and so to all respected doctors who have faithfully participated in all of the sessions today, we have arrived at the end of this webinar. We really hope that our webinar today will enrich our knowledge about the topics. Once again, we would like to appreciate for Sabang Merauke Eye Center, Indonesian Ophthalmologist Association North Sumatra Branch, Indonesian Doctor Association Medan Branch and North Sumatra Branch, and definitely PT Sunway Vision for supporting our event today. Our deepest gratitude as well to Professor Zoltan Nagy for his amazing lectures. But unfortunately, our professor has something important things to do in RAS. So perhaps now he has already leave. But not least at all, thank you so much to Dr. Gede Pardianto as moderator, also for Dr. Dea as the co-moderator, and absolutely to all of our distinguished participants for your enthusiasm in this webinar. And like the previous episodes, we would like to inform you that your e-certificate will be sent to your email few weeks after this webinar. Just a little bit patience. And we suggest you all to please check your email spam folder beside the inbox folder in case the certificate sent in there. Sometimes it happens. And absolutely, we would like to see you again at our next webinar episode, which is actually just in 2 days ahead. 2 days ahead, yes, this time, I mean, in this month of November 2021, we have 2 episodes, today's episode and the day after tomorrow's episode. So it means on November 21st, we will meet with our maestro, Professor Samuel Muscat from UCLA, USA, which will be presenting a topic with the title Management of Malfunctioning and Malpositioned IOLs. So make sure you register. We have sent the links for the registration of our webinar with Professor Samuel Muscat in the chat box, also in the live chat of YouTube. But if you miss in our chat box, don't worry, you will also receive that links in the email when we send your e-certificate. We really, really appreciate of you all. I mean, we really, really appreciate to all of your support and to follow, support our program. And don't forget as well to subscribe for our YouTube channel, 1 Hour with the Maestro. So you can always watch and learn these episodes and all videos from previous episodes of our webinar series. I'm Dr. Dia, as the Master of Ceremony, on behalf of the entire committee, want to say thank you very much for your participation to our webinar today. Have a good day, everyone, and goodbye.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again, when I see you again.
Damn. All the planes we flew, good things we've been through, then I'll be standing right here talking to you about another path. I know we love to hit the road and laugh, but something told me that it wouldn't last. Had to switch up, look at things different, see the bigger picture. Those were the days, hard work forever pays. Now I see you in a better place. See you in a better place. Can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I would do, you were standing there by my side. And now you gon' be with me for the last ride.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
I see you again.
We've come a long way,
yeah, we came a long way
from where we began.
You know we started.
Oh, I'll tell you all about it. See you again.
I tell you.
When I see you again.
First, you both.
go out your way and the vibe is feeling strong and what's small. Turn to a friendship turn to a bond and that bond will never be broken. The love will never get lost. And when brotherhood come first, then the line will never be crossed. Established it on our own when that line had to be drawn. And that line is what we reach, so remember me when I'm gone. How can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you gon' be with me for the last ride.
So let the light guide your way. Yeah. And every road you take will always lead you home. Oh, it's been a long day without you, my friend. And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. When I see you
excited to tell you that at this moment we have near 1,400 participants from 85 countries and 6 continents around the world.
That today we have near 1,000 participants from
53 countries across 6 continents.
We are so excited to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 76 countries across 6 continents.
So we are very, very excited to inform you that at this moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 74 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would also like to inform you that at this very moment, we have more than 1,000 participants from 81 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would like to inform you as well that at this very moment, we have nearly 1,000 participants from 65 countries across 6 continents around the world.
We would like to inform you as well that at this very moment, we have near 1,000 participants from 61 countries across 6 continents around the world.
Time is yours. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Leap off. Let's go.
Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure to speak with you. Nice to meet you over Zoom. It's interesting so that much. We meet people now across the world all the time.
And leap off. Give applause to Amar Agarwal.
Thank you very, very much, first of all, to entire Indonesia and also to all the 1,400 delegates watching from 85 countries.
Applause. Godspeed, my rejoicing.
Thank you very much for this extremely kind invitation and, of course, a very beautiful
introduction.
Thank you very much.
Time is yours. Leave off. Go ahead, Boris.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Gede, Pardianto, and all Indonesian ophthalmologists that were being so kind to invite me.
Applause!
Thank you so much, really, for organizing something like this, because it really kind of opens up so many channels of education.
Applause!
Well, thank you very much for the very kind invitation and how many international respondents you have. You obviously, the whole world is watching Indonesia.
Time is yours. Leave off. Here we go, David. It is showtime.
Thank you all, and everyone be safe. And I hope all of you around the world, how many people you reach with this. It's great. It's a great service. You're doing a great job. My congratulations.
Time is yours. Leave off.
Thank you very much. Konnichiwa, good morning. This is my first webinar using Zoom. Thank you.
Time is yours. Leave off. Applause. Godspeed, Dr. Firna, Zuli Oktariana.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a very kind introduction for me, Dr. Gede. I'm very honored to be here. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Leave off. Applause. Godspeed, Richard Hector.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Thank you so much for asking me, Gede, to be part of this wonderful series of webinars that you've been doing.
And Libo! Go ahead, Priya.
Thank you so much. I mean, I do not really have words to express how I'm feeling right now, but Dr. Gede Pardianto, I am totally blown out by this. Thank you so much for having me here and the entire Indonesian society.
Leave off! Godspeed!
Thank you very much, my good friend, Dr. Gede. I'd like to thank Dr. Pardianto right at the outset for inviting me to this fascinating one-hour maestro session.
Time is yours! Leave off! Applause! Godspeed!
Thank you. Thank you very much for this great introduction. I think it's the best introduction I ever had in my life.
Time is yours! Sleep off! Godspeed! See you soon!
Thank you for such a warm welcome and an awing introduction. Thank you so much for this great opportunity and this wonderful webinar reaching out to everyone around the world. I'm amazed at all the people around the world with